Afternoon, everybody. We're nearly there. This slot has been jokingly referred to as the cruise to snooze for the afternoon, so hopefully we'll make it as painless as possible. A couple of exciting things we want to talk to you about over the next 15, 20 minutes. But again, I suppose just to restate at the top of the show, it's great to be back here in person, having been doing a session like this remotely for the past couple of years. So to kind of step forward then you need to look at this new technology. Right, so that's me. So we've invested a lot in developing the customer success representative team over the past while. And I just wanted to give this role a bit of attention as part of today, because it's a really, really key role for us as we grow as an organization and as we scale. So we look at it as the customer success representative, the CSR, as almost like the quarterback of the relationship between Cora and its customer, okay? So they're the pivot point in terms of first point of contact around support issues, knowledge around the product, configuration changes, tweaks, access to best practice in terms of usage of the platform, and also to bring value to the relationship between the two organizations, to educate and to show the breadth of capabilities that each new release of the product provides. And you know, going back to Adele and Pat's team's sessions earlier on, you can see we've a very, very exciting roadmap coming over the next number of months and quarters. So what we've done in terms of that is I'm pleased to announce that James Dean has been appointed as the manager of the CSR group. So James brings with him a wealth of experience. He's got over 12 years worth of experience across all various different verticals, but also across the core areas of Cora as well, having worked in implementation, account management, and pre-sales, and so on and so forth. So James is heading up that group. And this is where we refer to kind of James's boy band. This is the One Direction group within Cora. Some of the lads have obviously been on the road longer than others, but in terms of that, really what we want to point to here, guys, is the fact that there's over 30 years of Cora experience in this group, okay? So these guys are coming to your aid and to your assistance and providing you with context around best practice in Cora. They're coming at it with real-world experience. So they've worked in implementations. They've worked in solutioning. They've worked in pre-sales. They've worked in support, okay? And in many cases, they've been with you in Cora for a long period of time. So there's a huge amount of corporate memory and experience and best practice that these guys can unlock with you and help shape the journey that you're going to be going on with us as we continue to educate you and make sure that you're availing of all of the capabilities of the platform that we can provide. A couple of things then in terms of the model of the engagement frequency that we want the team to have with you. Okay, so what we're working towards is this idea of a number of different cadences of interactions. And what we're trying to do with this shape of interaction is lift the conversation, okay? So very much we're focusing on, for example, from a support perspective, depending on what the frequency is required, we'll work with you to identify that. But in essence, we're working with you through support issues, making sure they're getting resolved, following up on them as quickly as is possible. But we also want to bring value to the relationships as well. And that's why we look to schedule a monthly success meeting with you, okay? And in that, we're moving away from kind of operational type support stuff. It's more, okay, look, this is how you're using the platform. This is how your peers are using the platform. These are the exciting new features that are coming out in the next release that we think would be relevant for you. And the CSR will be looking to build a roadmap for you as a customer to make sure that you're availing of and identifying additional areas that you can leverage the product's capabilities. The other piece that's important there is the quarterly board meeting or the QBR. Now, we'll work with you again from an understanding of what makes sense in terms of that cadence. But really what we're trying to do is look at the relationship between ourselves and our customers through a more strategic lens. And I'll talk about that in a second when we get to the next slide. We'll also, and I know some of you avail of this feature that we have, but we talk a lot about our how-to webinars. So on a monthly basis, there's a particular area of the product that we focus in on and we specialize on, and we run dedicated webinars to step customers through how to make the most out of those. We can do those on a per customer basis as well. So if there's particular areas that you're really interested in terms of your journey with Cora, the CSR can facilitate those kind of sessions to be created. And we'll shape them and we'll customize them specifically around the kind of feedback that you provide us. So expanding that idea of the QBR, the executive business review, really what we're trying to do is look at the lens of the relationship, look at the relationship between our organizations through a more strategic lens. So in essence, what we're trying to understand there is, okay, where are you guys going as organizations? What direction are you headed in? But also to ensure that you're aware of the direction that Cora is moving in. So this client conference is a fantastic forum for us to educate you in terms of where we're going. It's once a year. It may be more frequently if Suzanne gets lots of budgets and we all go to Vegas next year. Eh? Right? But ultimately, from that perspective, we want to be able to be having these engagements with your decision makers, your executive sponsors, your C-level folks. So you'll see members of the Cora SMT as part of those meetings. And ultimately, it's not an operational meeting. It's to understand the strategic direction that both of the organizations are moving on, giving an understanding of updates in terms of where the roadmap is headed, and also taking feedback as well in terms of where you're going and how you're finding things. So again, the CSRs will be looking to drive those sessions in your calendars. And again, they're a joint effort. So very much whatever you bring to the table, we can also mirror and manage as we move forward. So talking then in terms of the tool sets that the CSRs will work off, one of the key platforms that we've talked about the last 12, 18 months is Cora Assistant. And that's reached, I suppose, a point of critical mass for us now, that it's becoming an embedded tool as part of the discussions we're having with customers, but also it's a pillar application for the CSR as part of their day-to-day work and their day-to-day job. So, and in fairness, Ryan has stolen all of my thunder here now in terms of his session, but I suppose what we'll try and do is maybe, it's fortuitous, we'll put a bit of meat on the bones of some of the themes that Ryan mentioned in his presentation. And also going back to Roman and Jeff's session in terms of adoption and uptake and so on. So in terms of what Cora Assistant does, it does two things for us, okay? First of all, it's our digital adoption platform. So it provides that on-the-shoulder-based, context-based help for end users as they're working in the system. And I think Ryan's analogy was brilliant. If somebody's on a training course or they're looking at a video, they're not working, okay? But what Cora Assistant allows us to do is to roll out that context-based help as the person is working in the platform. So it has a little or no impact on productivity, but also it provides us with a number of other exciting opportunities as well. So In a sense, we have a central library of guides that we're continuing to create and build up on as we go with each main release. We're up to about 200 guides now that are available off the shelf within the Cora Assistant library. But we can create customized and bespoke ones as well to leverage your content. So if you've got a set of training collateral and training material, we can work with you to embed that within to specific guides for our customers for using the Cora Assistant platform. And thirdly, then, we can also tailor-make guides as well to reflect the methodologies that you're using the platform to underpin. So again, going back to one of the references to Margot's session this morning in terms of how do you roll out a global methodology across a wide organization, Cora Assistant is a really powerful element of that. And the third kind of strand to talk about in terms of what Cora Assistant gives us is that ability to understand how our customers are using the platform. So from a CSR perspective, they'll be bringing data points to you in terms of their interactions with you as customers to show you, okay, these are the features you're using, but more importantly, these are the features you're not using. These are the paths that your users are taking. This is the level of adoption that you have. This is the frequency of usage of the platform. So all of that underpinning what Jeff and Roman were talking about in terms of the adoption journey and harking back to Ryan's examples as well. So in terms of that, it basically brings us forward within the platform to be able to see and prompt the user to use these key kind of features. So again, this is an example of a guide, for example, that we've created, and probably a lesser known piece of functionality within the platform, which is the ability to create and manage milestones via the timeline view. So you can see that's a very visual clue, and almost the user is following exactly the steps that the guide is actually following. Okay? So from that perspective, there's no dependency on a couple of your key individuals within your organization to continue to be the single point of knowledge on all things Cora. This is a way for you to disseminate that knowledge in a consistent way across your entire user base. And from that perspective, again, we roll these out at various different points and various different junctures. So in conjunction with each new release, there's a new set of guides available. And in terms of mapping that out, we also have the guides as a companion piece to our central Cora customer portal library, which has over, I think, Kath, keep me honest now, up on nearly 400 different articles or artifacts between user guides, videos, tutorials, documents, and so on and so forth. So there's a wealth of information there for people to basically self-serve. Another initiative that we've rolled out over the last while is Cora Corner. So again, Cora Assistant gives us that ability to be able to communicate directly with the end user community. And we use this as a communication piece. So in essence, what it's allowing us to do is to generate updates to go out to the end user community. Now, we have discretion in terms of how we can do this. We can force the user to see them, or we can present it here as we're showing as an option for somebody to go in and see, well, look, here's information about the client, the Connect 23 conference that we're running with today. We issue one of these on a cadence of a monthly basis. So once a month, there's an issue of Cora Corner that comes out, and we use it as a means to showcase new functionality and also make people aware of new features that are coming or have been released. So it means, again, you don't have a single point of failure in your organization in terms of understanding what's in the latest release of Cora, what's happening, who do I need to talk to get a handle on what these new features are. This can be dynamically pushed. And again, what we are able to do is link back to our central library of guides and tutorials and all the other artifacts and elements that we have. And again, that's continuing to evolve. We have the ability to create editions of the Cora Corner on a customized basis for customers as well. So we have one central one that we publish every month, and the feedback has been very, very positive in that regard. And then similarly, if we need to create tailored views or tailored versions of the Corner for customers, we're able to do that also. And again, that's something your CSR is more than happy to kind of discuss with. The other point that we wanted to talk about here is how Cora Assistant can help drive behavior. Okay, so an awful lot of what Jeff and Roman and Ryan have talked about is getting the users into understanding best practice. So in this case here, for example, we're triggering the fact that, okay, there are outstanding workflow approvals. You haven't looked at that dashboard in a couple of days. Can you go in and actually make sure that you're reviewing things? And the guide will step the person directly through where they need to go to, and then also surface and say, for example, here, that they haven't updated their timesheet. Okay? So again, these alerts can be pushed at an agreed cadence to remind the user community that there are certain things that they need to do on a monthly basis or a weekly basis or an end of financial year or an end of quarter. And again, that's a really good example of a guide that's very graphical, okay, and that is very intuitive in terms of allowing the users to understand where they need to go on the platform, because, you know, it is a big beast, in fairness. It covers an awful lot of things. So from that perspective, it steps that person every step of the way, understanding what parts of the application they need to go to and where they need to input values, and they can do that dynamically. So again, speaking to Ryan's example, they don't need to take time off to fill in this information. They've got everything that they need at their fingertips. And that's something, again, I suppose, as we mature as an organization in our journey with Cora Assistant, that's something we'll be leveraging more and more of as we go forward. But all of that is very configurable and can be tailored to match whatever our customers' requirements are. Okay, final piece to touch on is the analytics, okay? So this is a pillar part of what the CSR's job will be, okay? The Cora Assistant platform doesn't just provide us with those kind of guides from an end user community perspective. What it does provide us with is a huge amount of analytical data that we can surface and we can bring to our discussions with you, our customers. So we're able to surface through, I think there's 38 unique widgets that we can get guidance from. And there's a couple of examples of that there. So things like the PES score. So that shows us the level of engagement, the frequency of visiting the application, and also what breadth of functionality has actually been used. what features are being used on an ongoing basis, how many visitors, and how long have they stayed, what's their frequency, and also understanding what are the key modules within Cora that are being used. And we can bring that knowledge to bear in terms of reference points between each individual customer and what their peer organizations are doing. So that then will shape the conversation that the CSR will have and will allow them to help you understand and how to leverage all the capabilities that the platform has and provides a roadmap for us to be able to plot a journey to make sure you're getting your most out of your investment in Cora. Thanks very much, everybody. I'm going to hand over to Vincent.
Anybody want to start from the floor if there's anything they need to ask about the roadmap, the direction, the vision, or any of the other stuff that's been presented by Derry and others earlier on? We have the microphone at the ready if there's any questions. I have Slido here as well. Did you have a question? Sorry, but you're raising your hand. Okay, let me go to Slido. For large projects which have 100,000 plus parts, how might we automate SCSS mapping to the schedule? Anybody able to answer that? Or even have a go at it?
So I think there's two approaches to that. It's one, understanding the data set that we'd be linking to, right? And identifying the key features that we can use to, again, link it back to the schedule. Because we have a number of attributes, and one of the things we developed over the last year that we didn't, I suppose, showcase today is the ability to add additional attributes against the task and also additional attributes against activities within that task. So if we can do that, and you know, it requires both teams working together for Cora from an implementation perspective, but also from the teams or the data sets that there we will be retrieving out of your systems and then do that matching automatically. So we have a number of approaches. We also have a manual process that for smaller, you know, installation, smaller bill of materials that you can manually link it back to a task. But when you mentioned the scale of 100,000 parts, that has to be automated, and that will be our approach into the future.
Okay, thank you, Pat. And maybe one for you this time, Derry. When will we see GPT embedded to Cora and or the Cora Assistant?
Sorry,
when will we see GPT embedded?
ChatGPT. Yeah. That's an interesting question, actually. We have looked at chatbots before from a support perspective, but that would have been a number of years ago prior to the arrival of ChatGPT. I would say what we'd need to do is probably discuss that with our core assistant supplier and see where that fits in terms of their roadmap. We've not hit a use case yet as to where the core assistant stuff would require that, because ultimately, most of the challenges that Cora Assistant is addressing is very functional, very specific to what the Cora platform actually does. Now, if there is a specific need around guides that are created bespoke for a customer, then obviously we can explore that. What we'll do is we'll take it as an action to liaise with our supplier and see what their roadmap journey is there. Okay.
Okay. So maybe a build on or an add on question to that is there a plan to use embedded NL search? What other uses, cases, are being actively worked apart from schedule predictions? I'm sure
I might take that one. So as part of the research that we did with Queen's University around the AI capabilities, and one of the things we looked at was the sentiment analysis from a project perspective. So what is the updates that the project manager, the team members are giving into the project itself, and also those sentiments that might be expressed from a customer perspective. And basically amalgamating that data set with, you know, the status of the project, financial information, to give you a true reflection, or maybe not a true reflection, but a reflection on where your project is at. And then that should be supported by the project manager to indicate, you know, is this project at risk? Is this project, running well? So that is one of the things we have investigated, and we're now looking to move that into the product as a whole.
And okay. Can I add one thing to that as well? In terms of the vision and what I mentioned earlier, we would like to hear more in terms of your business cases. We've prototyped a lot of things we think would be useful, hearing those usages of it. ChatGPT, I gave one example. Hearing yours in the tool really help, and that's something that'll help us also weigh when we're looking across what to do next in the ML space and prioritize that accordingly. So,
Okay, thanks, Ryan. And now there's an add-on question from what John and Yancey were talking about earlier on regarding the enhanced resource functionality that they were demonstrating. The question is, will users be able to resource weekly instead of monthly? Anybody know the answer to that?
Yes.
Yeah, that's a nice, simple answer.
Okay. Value added.
So, just checking around the audience, if there's anybody has questions, go ahead there.
Is this on? Sorry. I think you guys are going to get grilled on generative AI a little bit today with the amount of, you know, new applications that came out in the last month. I think it's even hitting thousands now. A lot of technology providers are looking deeply into how generative AI can support various tasks, because obviously the meaning of the word manual is changing with every new application that is actually being put out there. So my question was actually around Cora Assistant and whether you see any opportunity there for implementing that, but also what Ryan said earlier around scaling and scaling adjusting factor application, and that's kind of more in line with the AutoGPT technology that came out last month. I think there's a lot of opportunity to explore that, but my question is there any other specific areas that you might have looked into? I know someone mentioned before you worked with the Belfast University on exploring that. So are there any other areas that maybe you might be able to share with us at the moment?
I think the other area that we have explored is around OCR, document recognition. So, you know, searching through contracts, for example, or SOWs from a project perspective, and extracting the information from those documents and formulating an alternative hierarchy in some instances, or building, you know, key metrics into the project to measure and attach to different milestones and schedules from a project perspective. So again, that was part of the research program. So I think there's, you know, from an AI perspective, there is a lot of opportunities out there and how we can implement it again back into Cora.
Okay.
All right, I just have a couple things. You know, I do really want to follow up on generative AI and ChatGPT. I really do think, you know, we've really got to think about how we can leverage I have 100 use cases for you guys about how, not even just in Cora Assistant or training concepts, but actually in the application itself, where constantly people write things bad, right? And when we think about just textualizing data, right, that's a hard thing for people to do. So how can we drive actually external linking, you know, database actions to ultimately drive, you know, again for Ryan, right, the variance analyses that we evaluate on a monthly basis, because people can't write those things, right? We're horrible at it. So I really am interested in, as you think about integrating text-based AI, how you guys want to drive that and where that fits on your roadmap. Then my second thing is gonna be a little bit more on Cora Assistant. And as you think about the ability to configure guides in the system, you know, how can we drive to, you know, providing bespoke guides is gonna be something all of us need, right? We all have different business processes that we're trying to execute in the application. So how do we drive that to be an easier to implement thing as we look at expanding use of Cora Assistant? So those are my two.
I might answer the second one first, Ryan, then I'll hand over to the clever guys to my left. One of the things we're working and we're close to hopefully being able to announce is the ability to provide customers with the autonomy to create their own guides within Cora Assistant. So that's something we're working with the supplier on, and we're very close to being able to kind of firm that up. But the vision would be that, you know, it won't suit all customers, obviously, but that the challenge we have right now is that analytics piece, we don't have a means in our current configuration within Cora Assistant to securely provide access for customers to that data. And we absolutely do want to do that. So our vision is that we'll be able to create a secure space within our instance of Cora Assistant to allow customers to come in, view their analytics, and then if they wish, to have the autonomy to be able to create their own guides and take their own content and embed and shape that. But we want to do that in a controlled way, because what we want to do is make sure that they're also leveraging the centralized content that our team are generating. And you know, there'll be learnings that can be shared across the different groups. But yeah, I would be really hopeful in the next two, three weeks we'll be able to announce and pull the drapes off that. I think question one was...
The question one was kind of around what else we've considered. And I think the first thing to caveat with all this, being new technology, it is something we have to be careful with rolling out. We've already seen some usages of it in search engines where less than desirable results come back. There is a big part of it that's the data that you feed the tool. So when we talk about ChatGPT, we aren't talking about what you might see on TV. We're talking about putting something over our own data sets and kind of keeping that more straightforward. And we have to do a lot of testing with that, because one of the biggest risks is it returns the wrong information and you believe that because it told it to you. And so there's a level of a review. Initially, reporting makes the most sense because there's a component of it that has to be checked before it goes out the door. And it takes a lot of that time away. Long term, I mean, let's be honest, it could start writing the code. You can tell it now what types of languages and stacks you want to use, and it can write the actual code behind it. And so there are some very cool usages of it. But it will be with that caveat that we'll kind of ease into it, just do it responsibly, and look for reporting to be the first use case for sure.
OK. Thanks. Two nice questions from the floor. There are three, really. Let me go back to Slido for a second. One person said, you have been talking about next-gen UX. What's the plan for that, and how will it improve the usability for our users?
You want me to go that one?
Go ahead.
So, not to nerd you all out, but we're building Acuity on a React.js infrastructure with a new data returning system underneath it. It's far more performant. But the other thing it gives you is accessibility features out of the box, and it gives you a lot more support for mobile use cases as well. So there's phenomenal improvements in how we can both develop and deliver our interfaces, and a lot more flexibility we can give to our design teams about how they tackle some of these large use cases, like very, very large projects, and how we render very, very large project views for customers. So we can be a lot more innovative in how we tackle those problems. Because it's much, much easier to develop on.
Yeah, and we've got some of this data that you saw Derry run through. We can see where the tool is being used. We can clearly tell if there's a heat map on the screen of things that are not in use and things that are heavily in use. And we can count clicks, and we can do things now that are data-driven for that UX. It's not just a guess at what we think would look better or be better. And like, you know, like Lee mentioned, now we have the technology, too, to really harness that.
Okay, another Slido question. It's for Adele. You touched on alternative hierarchies earlier, and Ryan Godfrey also mentioned a topic during his talk. Can you elaborate on what it involves and how it can benefit our customers?
Sure. So as we've said, really it's alternative hierarchies, it's alternative view of your data. So if we think of the way that the Gantt is structured now, and we think about that in terms of what if I want to view my data from a financial point of view, what if I want to view it from contract or work buckets or work structure point of view, how do I pivot that data and be able to look at it from that point of view, to be able to visualize it, to be able to manage it in that way, and then to be able to So how do we visualize that? And then the benefits that that brings to the organization obviously gives you the ability to be able to see that data in whatever way makes sense for you. And then also to be able to align that data to your integrated systems in whatever way you need. So let's say your ERP system, you want to align your financial data so that you can have a more straightforward integration with that ERP system, as opposed to taking our current structure and being able to manipulate that data so that you can send it to the ERP system.
Okay, thank you. Anybody else want the microphone? I have a few more Slido questions, but I want to make sure that everybody has a chance. Go ahead there, Brian.
I want to talk about my use cases for alternative hierarchy. I think just from actually the client usage, I've got dozens of alternative hierarchies. So some of my most important ones are actually in my billing structure. So how do I know if I have specific, let's call them contract line items, and I have to bill within the guidance of those, how do I ensure that I can build my schedule how I want to execute it, but I can still understand where each of those schedule tasks are going to get billed? because that's a major, you know, importance when we think about the ERP system and creates a lot of challenges between ERP and schedule alignment. So that's an important one. And then also contract management. So a lot of times we have very complex contracts that we have to execute for our customers. So we might have incentives or award fee structures where we're able to get more profit or get additional contract value in certain circumstances. How do you link an alternative structure to that to drive outcomes of how you can deliver some of those awards or incentives? So those are just a couple of use cases. It's like my favorite topic is alternative hierarchies. So I won't say
who came up with it.
Yeah, I could see some real interest there from the point of view of what we can produce in the future. Just building on that a little bit about some items that are in the roadmap already and marked as complete, that was on some of the slides we saw earlier on.
Yep.
The question from Slido is, when will they actually be available to customers and when will we see some demos around that?
Delivery. Hand that over to Lee.
Yeah, so we're moving at quite a velocity in terms of delivering value out, but the release process is how we want to structure delivering that value to our customers. So,
I can't hear you.
Can you not hear me? Is that better? We do a weekly build within Cora, but believe me, all the customers don't want to be on that weekly build. You know, there's a few high touch support cases that we give. But what we do during the course of that 4-week period of weekly builds is we increase the stability. So then we will switch to a monthly stable customer release. And then we'll give our customers the choice of either upgrading monthly, so you'll get the closest access to the latest features that we're developing, or 3-monthly, so you'll be able to upgrade quarterly. And the objective is to keep our customers within 6 months of release. And then the actual capability and the features, just so that we're not polluting, I think, everybody's experience, we'll isolate key features behind license keys, which then can be discussed and unlocked as required for the different customers.
Okay, and just a slight add-on there in relation to the upcoming features that are coming down the line, et cetera, when will there be more granularity around that? And I'll just ask you to raise your voice a little, if you don't mind.
When are we doing the next customer release?
Yeah.
Yeah, we've got one lined up, so I actually need to meet with Derry and the support team to start to schedule the next release, which will come ahead of our planned Azure migration.
Yeah. Okay, great. Those are a good segue for you too, Derry, right? The CSRs would be the ones to ask for those.
Yeah, absolutely. I was just going to make that point that going back to the role of the CSR and where they fit in that communication journey, when a new product release is available, they should be surfacing those new features with you as part of those kind of monthly success meetings and identifying, based on the outputs of the information from Core Assistant, what are the features that will be of big benefit to you, and then obviously demonstrating them and bringing you on that journey. So that's a key part of the CSR role, and again, it's a means for us to kind of make sure that you're kept abreast of what's available in each release. The other piece I'd also talk about we talked about the QBR, the EBR type engagement. We'd also have a vision that there will be a slot in the agenda in each of those sessions to go through the roadmap as well, a tailored session to bring each customer through the version of the roadmap that is relevant to them also. So, all the communication around that is really making sure that everybody's working off the same page.
Okay, good. Believe it or not, we've come to the end of list of questions in Silo. So we're just almost at the very end. So my last duty of today, I'll leave you guys sitting where you are. You did a great job, by the way, is to introduce our head of marketing, Suzanne, who's going to close out our conference. And thank you for listening and engaging today. Thank you.
Hi, everyone. I'll keep this very short, but I think you'll all agree that was a great day. I found it really insightful. I think one of the major takeaways for me, I've been with Cora 6 years now, and when we started running these conferences, the speakers, you would have, I suppose at that stage, PMOs are really focused on cost optimization, but I think it's really clear today the evolution and that how PMOs are really delivering revenue, they're revenue generation offices rather than cost optimization offices. We heard about project profitability in Honeywell, competitive advantage in Northrop. and Margo as well, about the delivering value and value outcomes. So I suppose the PMOs are just, they're seen as mission critical now and not just a nice to have, but a must have in organizations, which is great. Obviously it makes our job a little bit easier. So thank you all. I'm going to do a couple of thank yous. First of all, I have a few items. So we are going to be emailing out a survey to get your feedback on how we can make this day even bigger and better. Like Derry said, maybe move it to Vegas next year, who knows? So I'd be really, really grateful if you guys can fill that out, so keep an eye on your emails. We will have presentations. We need a little bit of time to get, obviously, approvals to share those edits, etc. But we will share what we can with you. The social media competition, Oisín Murphy from Irish Rail, you are the winner. So I think Laura has a little gift for you that she'll hand over, so well done. And then I just have a couple of thank yous to go through, and I'm going to maybe mirror the processes that we've heard about today, from bid through to delivery. So first of all, I want to thank my mom and dad. No, I'm just kidding. first of all, I want to thank our CFO, John Fitzgerald, for approving the budget for this event. I'll not comment on whether I stuck to it or not. That's for another day. But that was nice. My marketing team, we've been living and breathing this event for absolute months. It's like a day job on top of the day job, and it takes a lot of people, and there's a lot of moving parts to make this happen, and they've been obviously critical to that. Specifically, Laura Matamo, our digital marketing manager, she has put a huge amount of effort. She is the ultimate project manager. I'm a disaster. I'm totally unorganized, but she has really made this happen, so just a little round of applause for Laura. Vincent, our wonderful MC, I think you'll all agree he did an absolutely fabulous job today, so thank you for that. Ali and Anya from High Tide, who ensured that this went off absolutely seamlessly over the last few days. I don't know how I ever managed an event without them before, so huge kudos. They totally just decreased the stress levels around this event for us, so thank you, guys. Who else? The AV team, amazing job, guys. The RDS, the venue has been outstanding. But I think the most important, or one of the most, is our speakers. There is no event without them. I think, you know, you'll now know that these guys are heavy hitters in the industry. They're very busy guys and gals. So we are absolutely honored that they made the time to come and speak with us today. So we thank them for that. So a round of applause. And finally, all of you in the audience, again, it's not an event without an audience. We had a great show of faces here today. It was kind of hard to even gauge numbers in the post-COVID times. You don't know who can from a corporate point of view. There's still travel bans in place. So we're really delighted to see such a good show of faces, and we hope that we'll see you all at the next one. So that is all my thank yous. I'm absolutely parched, so if anybody's looking for me and probably the rest of the Cora team, we're going to be across the road in the Horse Show House if you'd like to join us for a little beverage. So thank you, everyone. I hope you had a great day, and we'll see you again soon.